Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar. I'm Ishara Karunaratne. I'm the Director of Engineering in WSO2 IMBU. And I have Dulanjali Yenage with me. He's the Associate Director and Architect in WSO2, and also he's the lead in security and compliance team in WSO2. So in this webinar, we will discuss about the benefits of open source IAM and the risks that prevent open source adoption, and then how these risks have been mitigated in current open source IAM solutions. So at the end, I think this information will help you to select open source IAM solutions and use those components in your organization without any hesitation. So before I start today's webinar, for those who don't know about the WSO2 Identity Server, let me quickly go through about WSO2 Identity Server. It is fully open source IAM solution, which is under Apache 2.0 open source license. And its extensibility capabilities help you to build a unique IAM platform in your organization. At the moment, we are managing more than 500 million identities globally. We have 200 plus production customers, and we are OEM engagements. We have more than 500 universities and education institutes using WSO2 Identity Server. We have 24/7 support model, and we have offices globally. We have offices in US, UK, German, Brazil, Australia, and Sri Lanka. So those are the main offices. But we have a large partner network, and we work globally. So in the right hand side, you can see that several analyst recognitions we got. So in 2019, we were identified as overall leader in identity API platforms in KuppingerCole analyst reports, and we were named as a product leader in access management and federation domain, and also an innovation leader in CIAM solutions. And if you go and see Gartner peer reviews, we have I think at the moment we have 4.3 reviews from our customers, and last month, Forrester invited us to participate in the Forrester CIMA Wave. So that results may come in next few months. If I go through the capabilities we have in Identity Server, we support for the identity federation and single sign-on. We support most of the available open standards, OpenID Connect, SAML, WS Federation, and we have connectors for most of the social identity providers, such as Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, even Apple sign-in also supported with Identity Server. And we have the identity bridging capability, which helps you to transfer identity attributes in between several applications. It doesn't matter the protocol that you use. We as a product help you to transform the protocols and transform the attributes too with identity bridging capabilities. We have support for the strong authentication. We support many strong authenticators, including FIDO2, which can be used for the passwordless authentication, RSA Secure ID. Likewise, there are multiple strong authentication mechanisms we support, and not only a strong authentication. Nowadays, enterprise need adaptive authentication, which means the authentication should change based on the risk factors or the environment factors, because people, they don't like the static authentication flow. So adaptive authentication will help on those angles. So we have rich adaptive authentication support within the identity server. We have the account management and identity provisioning capability. We support a SCIM 2.0 protocol, and You can connect multiple user stores to the identity server, and you can automatically provision and deprovision users to the identity server and to the external systems automatically through identity server. And we have the access control capability, role-based access control, and the attribute-based, the fine-grained access control. We support for the SACML policy-based access control mechanisms. And we have a strong support for API security and microservice security. We kind of act as a key manager component for the WSO2 API manager, and then we have worked with many other API management solutions as well, and providing the API security capability for those API gateways. We have extended support for the OAuth framework. Many extended OAuth grants also supported, and microservice integrations also we do with identity server. Recently, we did open policy agent integrations and secure vault integrations as well to work with microservice platforms. And we have strong support for the privacy regulations such as GDPR, California Consumer Privacy Act, likewise. So identity server is fully compliant on those regulations, and it can be used to help to build a solution which is which can be certified for those regulations as well. And with identity server, we have the identity analytics capabilities. We have our own identity analytics engine, or if you have any existing identity engines, we have the APIs which can be used to connect with those engines. So this is a brief introduction of WSO2 identity server. Now let's start today's webinar. So before start that thing, I assume that those who have joined this webinar know about open source and what identity and access management is. So you all know it's been more than 30 years since open source was initiated, but now it has become the kind of theme in technology. So if you go to several items which highlight that fact. So last year, I think IBM acquired Red Hat for $34 billion. This is the largest software acquisition ever, and still Red Hat operate under IBM, and they continue their open source journey. And if we look at the cloud, it mostly run on Linux. Even if we look at Azure, Linux running more than 50% of the Azure workload. And if you know if you use the cloud native technologies, Kubernetes, Docker, those are mainly open source technology. Even if you think about the Microsoft, so it was the main competitor, or the main company who played against the open source. Now it is gradually become open source company. In 2018, they acquired GitHub, and 2019, they released their Edge browser in open source. So these are kind of highlights how open source is winning the market. So let's see why we need open source IAM components in your solution, right? So if you think about any digital transformation journey in you have, so in there, identity is a key requirement. So it may be employees, it can be customers, consumers, device, or workloads. So those are mainly different types of identity. In that case, this identity is a key concern, or identity management solutions are key component in your organization IT platform. But once you implement an IAM solution in a complete offering, it's very hard to switch from one IAM solution to the other thing, because you deal with identities, you have history of those identities, you have credentials. So changing one IAM component is not easy. And inflexible proprietary software license that result a high capital expenditure. And again, people think that vendor, non-vendor looking help you to easily move away from one solution to another one. So due to that reason, people try to use the softwares which support open standards, but that's not the correct view of vendor looking, because even if we think about the open standards, that's just for the integration. But what about the data you transfer? What are the different configurations that you have configured in those products? So what are the extensions you have done? So in that case, just using the open standards will not help you in vendor looking situation. So that needs kind of openness. You want to know what are the changes you have done in those components. So definitely we need open source and open standard to make you are free from vendor looking. And obviously openness make you more secure. So for all the code and all the documentation, everything is available for the public. That makes those components to be more secure. And again, so any business, so they are unique. Right. Even if you are competing in the same market segment, we have to find a uniqueness and we have to build the uniqueness to win the market. So to build the unique software offering, we can't use the available component as it is. So we may have to do some extensions to develop this uniqueness. So in that case, whatever the solution you pick, that should be extensible and it should have a development flexibility. So those comes from mainly from open source component. And again, if it's the product is open source, you can easily use it and develop on top of that thing. So that will help you to go to the market quickly. So these are kind of the facts or the points which highlight why we need open source IAM component in our organization. But there are several risks. I would say those are kind of myths that prevent open source adoption. So if we go through, we can see that many people discuss that security and compliancy facts in open source make it's not suitable for the enterprise use. And some say that enterprise readiness is not up to the level other proprietary vendors, and level of support and a lack of internal skills, that these things are highlighted as risks of going to the open source components or the solution. But these are not true. So most of the vendors in the open source mode go away from these things and they have fulfilled these requirements. So among these kind of security and compliance, you need more technical description and technical descriptions to say why we are in kind of mode where it can be used in the enterprise. So we have Dulanjan, he's the platform security and compliance lead in WSO2. So he will take you through how open source components are built with security as a top priority item.
Thanks, Ishal. So I heard a lot of comments and concerns regarding security of open source software. So one is, security is not a priority for such projects, open source projects. So during the software development lifecycle, security is not much of a focus for them. It becomes a focus only if a vulnerability is reported, but then again, for some such open source projects, then again, it doesn't become a priority. Then the next concern is the developers of such open source projects lack secure coding knowledge. So they know how to implement a functional requirement, but not how to implement a security control. So that's the general idea. And then some say open source products aren't compliant with security standards, like the ones defined by OWASP, SANS, NIST, and other such security governing bodies. And more frequently, I hear this fear of because code is open, it will attract more attacks. So are these fears valid for all the open source projects? So as Ishara mentioned, WSO2 is an open source company. We produce several open source products, but those are enterprise grade open source products. Now, should you have these same fears if you are to use an open source IT and access management product from a company like WSO2? So this is what we are going to look in the next set of slides. How can we be sure that security is there in whatever we build at WSO2 and the similar other IAM open source organizations? So at WSO2, regarding security, we believe several things. We believe it takes years of hard work to build a good reputation, but just one vulnerability and maybe a few minutes to destroy it all. We also believe the more we wait to incorporate security, the more challenging it becomes and more cost it will incur. And we also believe we have to invest in building and nurturing a security culture. And that will ultimately safeguard our reputation and our customers. So even though we are an open source company, this is what we call as our security mindset. So underneath this mindset, it boils down to whether we are being proactive or reactive. So what we target is to be proactive. What we target is to be considered security in all the phases of the life cycle. And even after delivering the product, releasing the product, then continuously monitor issues in the released version, help customers to sort out any vulnerabilities that can come in future. So we believe being reactive is the main reason for more cost and ultimately reputation loss. So this concept is instilled in all the engineers at WSO2. So how do we do that? So the first thing is building a security culture, right? So this is something we strongly believe in. So the first thing we did is to create a dedicated security and compliance team, a central security team, and then security champions in all the other teams. So the team that is building our open source IAM and access management product has security champions that has the domain knowledge of IAM as well as knowledge of security concepts. And they work closely with the central team, security team that where I also work. So we do a lot of research and we define processes and guidelines to do security correctly, but with the help of those engineers and those security champions, because it's a collaborative effort in order to have this security mindset at an organization. It's not security team just forcing something on others. We do regular trainings, security awareness sessions, and to make things interesting, we have challenges like capture the flag. So ultimately, we want to help engineers to think like hackers. So when it comes to security, thinking like a developer would not do much. You have to think like a hacker, right? How to break this? How someone will break this? So how can we protect it? So that is our mindset. So building a security culture is a never ending process. It's ongoing. So in our roadmap, we are planning to have a reward mechanism for identifying security vulnerabilities and taking security related initiatives within the company. So a quick look at what we do as a security team. We define security policies and procedures. We do a lot of security research and innovation, and these ultimately become security guidelines that our engineers follow. We train those engineers on those guidelines. We do evangelism within the company and outside as well in meetups and as blog posts and at conferences. And we integrate with external security tools, some commercial, some are open source. And whenever we can't, we don't have a tool, we build it from the scratch. And also we believe it's really important to maintain a healthy relationship with the security community. So by community, I mean the security governing bodies like OWASP, and the security vendors and independent security researchers who help us in identifying vulnerabilities and working with us closely until we resolve them. So all this research the team does will ultimately result in a defined set of security best practices. So we have multiple guidelines. Some are public, some are only within the organization. So if you visit WSO2 Secure Engineering Guideline, you can see an extensive list of best practices which are taken from OWASP, SANS, Oracle, and similar organizations. So engineers at WSO2 follow these guidelines throughout the lifecycle. Similarly, if you take Threat Modeling Guideline, which is an internal guideline, they adhere to this, they use this when they are doing secure engineering. We will see how these are used in the next set of slides. So one thing we strongly believe and encourage is security should not be an afterthought. It must be there from the very beginning. So it must be there from the designing phase itself. So that is why at WSO2, design reviews are mandatory. And it is mandatory for software architects and security leads of these teams, in this case, IT and access management team, to participate in those design reviews. So in this review, the design is evaluated from different perspectives, and we use what we call as the STRIDE model for that. So STRIDE basically categorizes security attacks. For example, you can see on the left side, spoofing, tampering, repudiation, information disclosure, denial of service, and elevation of privilege. So we look how our design can be attacked from these viewpoints. Right. So in this process, we use the security engineering guideline and threat modeling guideline that we discussed in the previous slide. Right, then we come to the developers who's going to implement this. So when implementing, they have to make sure they follow security engineering guideline throughout that implementation phase. After writing the code, they have to run find security bugs, which is an open source static analysis plugin, and use OWASP OZ attack proxy for dynamic analysis. And also when they are sending the PR, there's a PR template that ask that validates whether this engineer has gone through that engineering guideline, whether that engineer has run the scans. And also if a new third-party library is needed, so WSO2 uses a lot of third-party libraries, right? We don't want to reinvent the wheel. If a new one is needed, then there's an approval process where the approval needs to be done by the security team and by the engineering leads. In order to get the approval, that dependency needs to be scanned from OWASP dependency check, and it should not have any vulnerabilities. If there are vulnerabilities, they can't use that dependency. They need to find an alternative. Then once the PR is sent, it's the merging state. So it is mandatory to have a code review before merging. So one or more security leads of the product domain and other technical leads must review the PR and must review the code. Here again, those leads will be referring to engineering guide, secure engineering guideline to make sure the developer has adhered to that. And also they will verify whether how developer has implemented the security controls is according to what we discussed in the design phase, according to what we identified from the threat model. So these steps will be done before merging any code to the repositories. So after merging, we come to the releasing stage. So a release can't happen without doing security scanning. So the security team has the veto power to -1 any release, to stop any release, right? So in order to release to happen, it requires the team does a static code analysis using VeraCode, which is the commercial tool, and dynamic analysis using Qualys. So both of these are well-reputed tools in the security domain. And also for third-party dependency analysis using another OWASP product called Dependency Track, and also CLEAR, which is used to scan the images of the release products. So these checks are mandatory. If there are vulnerabilities, it can't be released until those are mitigated. Right, so this is the big picture, right, what we discuss. So there will be secure design reviews, then developer self reviews, then code reviews, and security leads will be being participated in this. And also throughout this, throughout all these phases, secure engineering guidelines and other internal guidelines like threat modeling guidelines will be used. And multiple tools, as we discussed, like security find security bugs, Zap, and such tools will be used here. And then we came to the product release process where we use VeraCode, Qualys, and Dependency Track to make sure the release is safe, right? And then we feed these to something we call a scan report repository for future use, right? And then we have something called the vulnerability management system, where we store all these vulnerability information and what actions we took on them. Okay, so we've done the release. Then the customers will go and deploy these in their environments. So we can't just forget about security after releasing. So we have to care about the security of the custom deployment. So that's why we have well-defined public security guideline documents, right? Which discusses the security measures that needs to be taken to ensure product level security, OS level security, and network level security. So in the product level, it's like change in the default key store, change in the default admin credentials, strengthening the TLS communication, choosing stronger ciphers, and then defense in depth mechanisms where you do security hardening in the OS and at the network level. So we have clearly defined this in order to help the customers to ensure the security of their deployment. So we are going beyond our releasing our software development lifecycle into the deployments of customers. Right, so we've done our best, right? So in all the phases of the software development lifecycle, we focused on security, right? Even in the deployment, we provided clear guidelines, but still there could be some vulnerabilities that crept through that we missed, right? From all the scanners, from all the eyes of the security leads, right? So this happens in any system. So we need to have a clear vulnerability management process in place when we identify such a vulnerability to mitigate it quickly. So this is the process followed at WSO2. So initially we receive a vulnerability. It can be a report from an independent security researcher, which comes through our dedicated confidential security channel, security@wso.com email. Or it could be a customer reporting an issue through the support portal, or it could be from internal testing, internal penetration testing, or it could be some vulnerability that we identified during the pre-release scanning, right? Because we have to backport that fix to all the other older versions. So once they receive this, security team receive this, then with the product team and the security team together, they evaluate this issue and see whether it's a true positive. And they calculate the actual impact to the product. So once it is confirmed it's a true positive, we move to fixing it. So the product team will be working on this. So IAM team will be working. They will be doing any change in the code or a config and ultimately merge to the development branch. Then we can't stop there, right? We can't stop just fixing the issue for a particular version that was reported. We have to backport and frontport. So we have a porting policy. So we will be creating patches for all the versions that is defined in that policy. And then we have to distribute these fixes to the customers. We have a scheduled monthly customer announcement for distribute all such security fixes that were done within the month. But if the issue is critical, we do an immediate announcement. So after giving 4 weeks, a grace period for our customers to apply the fixes, we do a public announcement. We publish these on our website. Now, if the issue is reported by an independent security researcher, we have to provide acknowledgement, right, as a goodwill. So we will be listing their name in our public acknowledgement page. So this process is a collaboration between the product team and the central security team. So throughout these software development lifecycle phases and the deployment and throughout whole processes of security, we are using lots and lots of tools, right? Some are commercial, some are open source that we already discussed about, right? So we use Qualys, Veracode, which are commercial tools, then FindSecBugs, Clair. We use a bunch of OWASP products, right? So OWASP is the de facto security governing body globally, right? So we always tend to use their products. And sometimes those products will not match all our requirements, right? We will not fulfill all our requirements. So we will be creating extensions, and then we always try to contribute those back to these OWASP products. So if you go, for example, OWASP DefendDojo repository, you can see WSO2 as a sponsor. Right? So we are continuously try to give back to the security community. So as I mentioned previously, it's not just one company effort, it's a global effort when it comes to security. And then there are a bunch of applications that we develop in-house whenever we can't acquire or adapt something from the outside. So one is Security Scan Manager, which will conduct scans from multiple scanners. Then we have Security Issue Manager, which makes sure there are no delays and makes sure the patches are covering all the versions in the policy. And then we have an Announcement Manager, which does custom announcement and public announcement in a timely manner. So we always try to automate. So we believe by automating, we will increase the efficiency of security processes, and ultimately it will leave us more time where we can focus on research and then ultimately contribute more to the guidelines and more to evangelism and help our engineers become better to gain better knowledge on the security domain. Yes, we take security seriously. So you might have noticed that during the previous slides, right? So this is our wso.com/security public page. This is sort of the hub for everything that is public about what we do on security space. Right? So you can visit this, and there you can find links to our secure software development process, vulnerability management process, secure engineering guidelines, and deployment guidelines. And whenever we do research, we publish here as well. You can see a blog, a link to a blog for same site attribute support in WSO products. So this is another instance where we've been proactive. So same site is it's an enforcement that is being done by Chrome and other browsers, right? So without letting our customer deployments be disrupted by that, we did proactive research and we patched all our products in order to become adhere to this enforcement. So these such details you can refer from this page. Right. So this is the ultimate question, right? Does open code attract more attacks? So do you really think that serious attacks are driven by how easy it is to attack? No, it is by the value of what will be gained. And most closed source binaries can still be decompiled and view the code unless it is obfuscated. And static scanners like Veracode can find vulnerabilities by just scanning the binary. And how much you try to even encrypt or obfuscate, still a serious attacker can reverse engineer and figure out the execution flow of the application. And also there are many black box security testing tools, and they don't care whether the code is open or closed, right? For example, you can easily find security, SQL vulnerabilities using a tool like SQL Map. Also, a malicious person who's willing to put an effort to understand the open source code, it is not easy. It will take time to understand the whole flow, who's not familiar with such code. That person will put the same effort to understand the execution flow as we mentioned in previous slide, reverse engineering or trying to decompile in similar manners. So they will put effort if they are really serious. It won't stop whether the source is open or closed. And the sad thing is some closed source vendors and sometimes even their customers have a false sense of security because their code is not open. So this might ultimately lead to delays in vulnerability mitigation. An advantage of being open source means there are multiple eyes looking at the code, multiple non-malicious people looking for vulnerabilities. So that means ultimately those vulnerabilities will be mitigated faster. Right. So does open code attract more attacks? No. Okay, so let's revisit the previous security fears we talked about. Security is not a priority for open source projects. It's a myth. So there are some projects where it is the priority. So as you saw, security is a priority throughout our software development lifecycle and even beyond that. Open source developers don't have secure coding knowledge. It's a myth, right? So you saw how we develop guidelines and we conduct a lot of trainings on them to improve the knowledge of our engineers. Open source products are compliant with security standards. You saw how we are preparing our guidelines based on OWASP, based on SANS and other such governing bodies. And we use a lot of tools from OWASP itself to make sure our security processes are aligned with those requirements. And finally, we discussed code being open attracts more attacks. It's a myth again, right? So ultimately, when it comes to security, it's not about the code being open or closed. It is whether an organization has a security mindset and whether they are proactive. So this will determine whether you should have those fears on an open source project, open source company or not. So let me hand over back to Ishara to discuss further on other perceived risks that we looked in previously. Ishara, back to you.
Thank you, Dulanja. So you know how seriously we consider security in WSO2. Even we are an open source company. Likewise, there are open source solutions that go beyond the simple open source projects, and even they go beyond the proprietary software. So there's a new segment within the open source solution. We call it that as a enterprise ready open source, or we simply say enterprise open source. Those softwares definitely open source softwares, but they are tested, hardened, and supported for enterprise use. So we identified those open source solutions as enterprise open source solutions. So WSO2 is enterprise open source company, and WSO2 Identity Server also ran enterprise open source identity solution. So what is the difference between the simple open source solutions and enterprise ready open source solution? So obviously both are open source. So the source code is open source. They have a community around that product that help for the open source users, and they are backed with open source license, maybe Apache 2, GPL, like that. And when it comes to support, most of the time, open source, just open source product, they have the community support, but enterprise ready open source solutions, they have the premium support. It's not only helping you to develop or helping you to fix the issue, but they have extended support capabilities such as technical account managers, proactive customer handling via customer success associates, likewise. and training and certification. Most of the time for the open source solutions, we can't see, but when it comes to enterprise grade, they will provide training and certifications for those open source products. And when it comes to the development, most of the time we build solutions or the integrate different component internally. Maybe we go to another service integrator to get it done for us. In that case, this partner network is really important. So in enterprise open source solutions, we can see a huge partner network. So they will operate globally. So even if you go for an open source solution, they will help you to integrate those solutions easily. And enterprise ready features. So if you think about the simple IAM solution, simple open source IAM solution, they provide a single sign-on, they provide login, kind of basic capabilities. For the basic IAM requirement, those sign up. But when you build an enterprise-grade solution, you need strong authentication capabilities, passwordless authentication, especially when it goes to the customer-facing identity requirements, you need these kind of things. You need adaptive authentication capabilities. So based on the security risk or the consumer's preference, you can enforce different authentication mechanisms. You want to connect your existing users to. If the merge or the acquisition happened, you want to federate your users to the other company premises. So those capabilities, kind of enterprise requirements, should be incorporated in your IAM solution. If it's an open source IAM solution that provides those capabilities, you can consider it as enterprise ready open source IAM solution. Then again, in the enterprise, when we build a solution, we allocate a huge budget for that and we plan for that. So just having a component and a simple update, if it breaks the whole system, it won't work, right? In that case, we need a predictable life cycle on that project or the product. And even if we want another requirement, there should be a commitment from that open source organization to deliver it within a given timeline. In that case, open source enterprise ready open source IAM solutions will provide that guarantee as well. So Dulanja discussed most about the security and compliance related stuff. So when it comes to the enterprise solutions, they act more proactive. They don't wait till the customers or the users find the bug. They identify it before others, and then they will notify the customers and they will send the mitigations as well. And they will go through all the security development practices they follow, right? So that is the simply difference between the open source solution and open source solution which are ready for enterprise ready. So in that case, so if you want open source component, there are many enterprise ready open source solutions available in the industry. You can simply go for those things. So what are the benefits you get having an open source or an enterprise ready open source IAM solution in your organization? Obviously, it's a high quality software. So the code is open, so you know what is available there, right? So you can easily understand the things available there. Definitely it will be with the more quality, because if it's open, we should maintain those qualities in the product. And obviously it will provide better security. Definitely they will go through the secure software development life cycle as Dulanja explained. And again, since it's open, again we need to get more precautions to make it more secure. Since we have this enterprise ready capabilities such as strict SLAs, training, certification, supports, define roadmap zone. So you can get the ability to safely leverage this open source technologies in your organization. Since the product is open source, there's a low total cost of ownership. And again, since this is open source, even you can help them to build the component, and there you can access the latest innovation in those products in the component. So those are the kind of benefits you get from an enterprise ready open source IAM solution in your organization. So this is how in WSO2 or the WSO2 identity server become an enterprise open source IAM solution. We have been recognized, we are recognized with many analysts in the IAM domain. So in the beginning also I explained, so Kubinga Call identified me as a leader in identity API platforms. We have 24/7 support and we have the training certifications. We have a global partner network, so you can simply log into the WSO2 site and go through. And security is a top priority in WSO2 and WSO2 identity server. So this is a quick comparison of available open source IAM solutions. So I can guarantee that WSO2 identity server is an open source, and again, it's enterprise ready open source IAM solution, but I didn't go through other solutions that much. So if you pick one of these other solutions, please go through these solutions and see their enterprise readiness. This is a simple feature comparison. So I took this information from the Gartner open source IAM offering. So and I added some available new information to that as well. In the identity governance and administration segment, we can see Midpoint, Sofit, and SimCorp playing. And login and SSO is provided by many other solutions. So if you go to the Glue, they support login, single sign-on. They have API security capabilities and provisioning. KeyClock, they provide login, SSO, and fine-grain authorization. Midpoint, they are mainly focused on IGA and provisioning. Shibboleth is a well-known single sign-on provider based on XAML. And Sofit, they're also working on IGA, login, and SSO, and provisioning. SimCorp is another open source solution. Work on IGA and provisioning segment. In WSO2 identity server, in the beginning also I discussed the features. So we support for the login, single sign-on, federation, fine-grain authorization, API security, provisioning, and adaptive authentication. So there are other open source solutions as well. These are the kind of prominent open source players. So that's all today we wanted to talk. I think you got a clear idea how open source playing in the market, what is the benefits of those open source components, and especially I think you got some idea why you should not worry about the myths around open source. Now, most of the open source solutions are enterprise ready, so it will give you more benefits compared to other proprietary vendors. Yes, that's all today. So thanks for joining. So if you have any questions, we have a few minutes to answer. Yes, how about privilege access management? Yes, for the privilege access management also in WSO2 identity server, we don't play in that market, but there are open source vendors for in that segment as well, but I didn't put any of these here. But obviously, if you search, you can get that solutions. But when it comes to privilege identity management, so first you need to identify which level of privilege identity management capabilities required, because most of the IAM solution, even WSET identity server, they have a basic level of support. So when you build the solution, better to figure out up to what level you need. So based on that thing, you can select the solution. Yes, does IAM support single sign-on for systems like Windows, Linux, along with application? Yes, in WSET identity server, we have that capability. Most of the time, if you ask any IAM specific question, so I answer related to WSET identity server. I think other IAM players also supporting some of these capabilities. So please search those things if you want to know about other product. Since I am from WSET, most of my answers will come through that. Sorry for that. Okay, it seems there's no more questions. So thank you for joining today's webinar. We will share these recordings and slides with you guys. And even if you have any questions, you can, from the beginning of this slide, you have our email addresses. So you can directly email us. Or even if you come to the WSET2, there are several community channels. So you can join and ask any question from there. Yes. So thank you for joining today.